Welcome to the motherfucking relay. We're covering today's top boxing news.
Okay, let's start with this. Well, per a tweet from Michael Benson, Bob Arum has revealed he's been in contact with Josh Taylor's people in the aftermath of his World Boxing Super Series triumph. As well as wanting the undisputed fight with Jose Ramirez, Arum said they're very interested in Terrence Crawford being a future foe at welterweight. And this is a proposition that at least by now, I think we're all familiar with. That regardless of who wins the undisputed 140-pound title fight between Jose Ramirez, the unified champion, and Josh Taylor, the unified champion, the winner of that fight is a shoe-in to square off against what was the undisputed champion at 140 before they came along. That's right. Undisputed champion versus undisputed champion. That's what that fight would be. I dare say that's a sensational fight. Fantastic fight. The best kind of fight you could ask for as a boxing fan. Terrence Crawford was undisputed at 140 pounds, so it's only right that the winner of that fight test their mettle against him. In order for the fight to be everything it can be, however, it does have to happen in a certain sequence. I mean, it really does have to be about Ramirez versus Taylor before it becomes about either of them fighting Terrence Crawford. It really does have to be about those two guys, those two fighters, first. Stylistically, it's a dream match. Josh Taylor versus Jose Ramirez, oh yeah. I mean, they're both definitely high-level guys. Guys of the highest order in the 140-pound division. But what makes it a titillating matchup is that both of these guys just so happen to have the same sweet spot. They both do their best work within close quarters. Neither Jose Ramirez or Josh Taylor is a safety-first, outside kind of fighter. They're both mid-range to inside guys. So you put them both in the ring with each other, and you're going to get World War III. That's what you're going to get. It's questionable what would be the best location for such a matchup. I think that with the Mexican-American fans here on this side of the Atlantic Ocean, it's conceivable that Jose Ramirez, his Mexican following, you know, him versus Josh Taylor for what is the undisputed 140-pound championship, I think that really could draw a crowd. Mm-hmm. I mean, Jose Ramirez has put up numbers as high as 14,000 domestically. He has. Most people don't realize this, but that's because most people don't know shit about boxing. In many spectrums, actually. And a fight like that here, I think it could do well, but I don't know if it could be billed as a pay-per-view. That's the thing. Jose Ramirez doesn't yet have the kind of following to where you could put him on a pay-per-view with some certainty that you'd get a return. He's not there yet. And Josh, God bless him, he's more of a draw over there on the other side of things, the other side of the Atlantic Ocean, than he is here in America. I think in the realm of selling out a venue and simultaneously billing the fight as a pay-per-view, I think the ideal location, if that's the goal, would have to be over there in the United Kingdom, and that might sound repetitious, but do realize that the price point they're paying over there
isn't as inflated as the one
here. It's far less than the price point we've been paying over here. The price point here does more to deter customers as opposed to drawing them in, whereas over there in the United Kingdom, you know, you're talking about essentially, what, $25 for a world championship fight? A fight you know will not disappoint at a price point that is far more affordable to the common man than what people are paying over here. What people are paying over here leaves them so inclined to seek other avenues, other alternate resources to take in a championship boxing match free of charge.
It's reality.
You hear it all the time from these guys that talk up the PBC and whatever pay-per-views they're putting on. You know, why should I pay to see the fight when I can watch it for free? You hear that all the time, okay? But if the fight were more affordable, you'd draw in more people as a result of that. They wouldn't feel so inclined to steal the fight to save some coin, to save some change.
It's reality.
And that's why you'd likely get more success staging a fight like this as a pay-per-view in the United Kingdom as opposed to the United States. It's because the price point here is overinflated and boxing fans are simply tired of it. Consider how much energy is being poured into, you know, the latest pay-per-view that we saw a couple of days ago or whatever, the Deontay Wilder versus Luis Ortiz rematch. Okay, you got guys out there trying to talk this thing up as if it actually did 300,000 pay-per-view buys. As if 300,000 is some kind of a sensational number. I mean, even if the lie that these guys are telling were true, that's still not a big number, you understand?
So why lie about it?
We know what the reports are saying. We know that the actual reports from the actual pundits say in plain English that the fight didn't do 300,000. But even if we go with the lie, even if we believed the lie, Well, 300,000 really ain't a big number either. Over there in the United Kingdom, you might actually draw more for the fight between Taylor and Ramirez because they've already seen Taylor in action against Prograis. They like what they saw. They know how he gets things done. And the boxing fans over there are a little bit more educated than the boxing fans over here. They know what Jose Ramirez brings to the table. They saw what he did to Maurice Hooker in their unification match. Those boxing fans are more likely to flip the bill to see the fight and put the money out than the guys over here. The guys over here, they're either going to go on Fire Stick, Instagram, or a Facebook live stream to watch the fight for free. Thus, if the goal is to turn over some coin, the fight really would be better suited in the United Kingdom as opposed to the United States. And I think that both of these propositions are actually very realistic propositions, highly probable, likely to happen. I think the Top Rank is going to be shooting for a bigger 2020 than 2019 was. You know, the way things have worked out, they're in a position to stage some sizable events in the coming year. The fight between Comey versus Lopez, the winner of that fight next year will be set to square off against Vasyl Lomachenko. That could be a sizable event, that could be a sizable fight. They've got an open line of communications with Josh Taylor, trying to hammer out a deal that would see him fighting Jose Ramirez. That could be a sizable fight. It all depends on when and where it takes place, but that could be a sizable fight. The WBO champion, Jamel Herring, could be squaring off against Carl Frampton in Belfast. And I dare say that in Belfast, that could be a sizable fight. I don't like Carl Frampton's odds in that match. I don't. I think Jamel Herring has everything it takes to beat Carl Frampton. That it's going to be a far cry from what Carl just dealt with in Tyler McCreary. Good preparation, yes. They've certainly got the right idea, but Jamel is a cut above a Tyler McCreary. Better still, that fight in and of itself in Belfast. You know, Carl Frampton shooting for what could be potentially becoming a three-division champion. Yeah, in Belfast, that'll draw a crowd. Lest we forget, the newly crowned WBO champion, Shakur Stevenson. The wheels are already in motion. To see him traveling over there to that side of the Atlantic Ocean to unify titles with the likes of Josh Warrington. I dare say that Top Rank will have a bigger 2020 than 2019 was. Moving on. You might have noticed there on YouTube in the last couple of hours that there's certain channels out there that for some reason seem to be trying to float their own set of pay-per-view buys, their own set of numbers in regards to what the Wilder versus Ortiz rematch did on pay-per-view. Even though none of the accredited pundits, neither Jake Donovan or Dan Raphael, none of these guys are reporting that that fight brought in 300,000 pay-per-view buys, for some reason, got guys like Fanon, got guys like 78 Sports, some other guy, looks like Jabba the Hutt, named Cali Enigma. These guys are calling the pay-per-view a success.
What?
These guys are floating their own set of numbers under headlines like Wilder versus Ortiz 2 did 300,000 pay-per-view buys. And this is in spite of, you know, the actual pundits themselves saying in plain English that the fight did not bring in 300,000 buys, that it came in under that.
Can y'all read?
One must ask, what's going on here? Why are these guys floating these fabricated numbers, inflated numbers, really? Why are they doing this?
Why?
I'll tell you why. It's damage control.
They're embarrassed.
It's quite obvious that that's what it is, too, because these are the guys that are trying to convince the boxing community that Deontay Wilder is some kind of a star. Yet, whether you go with 138,000 pay-per-view buys or 275,000 pay-per-view buys, regardless of which number you decide to go with, it doesn't matter, because all those numbers communicate the same thing, that Deontay Wilder is anything but a star. So what these guys are going to try to do is perform some damage control.
For him.
They're going to take a number. They're going to take the number that's on the higher end of the spectrum.
Of course.
In a situation where the number could be anywhere between 138 to 275,000, these guys naturally went with the higher number on the higher end of the spectrum because it suits their narrative. And they're going to take that number that might actually be an inflated number, because some people are looking at that 275 and saying, no way, Jake Donovan is inflating the numbers. They're going to take that number and inflate it.
Let's talk about the pay-per-view numbers first. 300,000 pay-per-views, and I'm saying 300,000 pay-per-views. I ain't saying 275.
even further by saying in their headlines that Wilder did 300,000, even though no articles corroborate that number. Every single article, every single number floating around states quite plainly that it didn't do 300,000 buys. Even the most generous estimates don't put it at 300,000 buys.
So why are you guys doing that?
You're literally adding another 25,000 pay-per-view buys to the buy rate that no one is reporting. This is all you. This number is literally coming from you because it's not coming from the pundits. The same pundits that you're using as a source to debunk Rick Glacier's number, well, those same pundits are saying that it didn't do 300,000 pay-per-view buys. So why are you saying that? I'll tell you why. It's because these guys are a part of a network that really is in the business of misinformation. They want to misinform, miseducate as many members of the boxing community as possible because it suits their narrative. It doesn't suit their narrative in this situation to simply tell the truth. That after 10, 11 years, approximately 42 professional contests, 10 title defenses, it doesn't suit their narrative to say that after all this time, Deontay Wilder still can't draw. That the best that he can do off his own name at the live gate was a meager $4 million. That's all he could do.
That's it.
Understand that when the guaranteed purses to the fighters, both Wilder and Luis Ortiz, when those guaranteed purses were first reported on, it was kind of embarrassing for these guys. And it was coming from a reputable source. It was coming via the commission itself. A more reputable source than a couple of middle-aged men pointing cameras at their face and monetizing videos on YouTube.
I'd say so.
You gonna argue with the commission? Is that what you're gonna do? It's kind of embarrassing for these guys because they want you to believe that Wilder's a star, yet based on that guarantee, he stood to make less guaranteed from this fight than he made in the Fury fight. That's embarrassing for these guys because these guys, they want you to believe that Wilder's stock is on the rise. Well, if his stock's on the rise, why was he being guaranteed less for this fight than what he was being guaranteed for the Fury fight? Why is it that the ballpark estimates for this fight are actually less than the ballpark estimates for the Fury fight?
Why?
If his stock is on the rise. The easy answer is, his stock's not on the rise. And Fury helped him sell that fight, like I've been saying. Better still, when those numbers were first reported, these guys were kind of embarrassed, so they latched on to whatever they could latch on to. And that came in the form of a tweet from Dan Raphael.
For the sake of what people continue to give out about how much money people make and all that good stuff, Dan Raphael is as good a source as anybody else. So, the guarantees for the two main event fighters are roughly $20 million and $7 million. And that, my friend, is without the upside of the pay-per-view. So it could be $20 million or more.
These guys latched onto that tweet. They used that as gospel. They made videos all about it. The whole fucking middle-aged network made videos about how Wilder stands to make more than just $3 million. But that same Dan Raphael, he's not reporting 275 or 300,000 pay-per-view buys like Jake is. Dan's saying it did 225,000. So if Dan's number, if his numbers, if his sources, his resources, if his resources were good enough a couple of days ago, why aren't they good enough today?
Huh?
Why aren't you sticking to his number? He's saying 225, not 275, and certainly not 300,000. But here today, I guess Dan's not good enough.
Well, he's no good now, huh?
What they're doing is trying to convince you of something. So Dan Raphael comes up with 225. Not like Jake Donovan, who I believe did an honest article.
Yet another example of the brazen hypocrisy, the brazen effort to spread misinformation that is associated with this conglomerate of middle-aged men who make a profit off of lying to people. These guys aren't dissimilar from Joel Osteen and Creflo Dollar. They just do it with boxing. That's all. They tell people stuff they want to hear so they can turn over a profit.
Days ago, they were just fine with Dan Raphael and what he had to say, whoever his sources are. They were just fine with it. They ran with it. A couple of days later, they've so decided to go with someone else, someone who's reporting an even bigger number than what Dan is reporting.
275, huh?
Which is no surprise to me and you. Because 275,000, well, that sounds a lot better than 225,000, and it certainly sounds better than what Rick had it at. Rick had it at 138,000. Jake Donovan's got it at almost double that amount, so naturally, that's the number they decided to go with.
Of course.
Except they're taking that number and adding to it even further. They're adding an additional 25,000 buys to the buy rate, even though nobody's reporting that. What's being reported is the opposite of that. no matter which report you go with. Ladies and gentlemen, what state of mind does one have to be in to regularly engage in this kind of tactless behavior?
Shit is ridiculous.
These guys got no integrity and they got no shame.
Deontay Wilder was crazy for passing up $12.5 million against Anthony Joshua that people claim that they really meant. Now, when I say he passed it up, don't get me wrong. I'm not saying that I believe that Anthony Joshua and Eddie Hearn were actually serious about fighting him or paying that money. I'm just using the $12.5 million because that was out, because that's a number that people put out there in the public.
See that, ladies and gentlemen? That is what's called a revisionist's version of history.
How so?
What this gentleman here is attempting to do is give you a skewed perception of events long since past, and he's going all the way back to April of 2018 when Eddie Hearn first made that $12.5 million offer to Deontay Wilder. That was the initial offer made to Wilder to take on the fight.
12.5 mil.
And what Fanon, in his fashion, is trying to communicate is that Wilder was right to turn down the offer because look at what he's making today, over a year later. But lest we forget.
What?
What makes this a revisionist version of history is that he's not telling you what Wilder's market value was then as opposed to what it is today. It's been over a year.
Well over.
Whereas back then, Deontay Wilder's highest purse was a meager $2 million. $2 million that he got for the Luis Ortiz fight, whereas what Eddie Hearn offered him was well in excess of that. It was actually six times
that amount
higher than Deontay Wilder's highest purse. He turned that down. To make matters worse, we all know that there have been several offers since that time, each one bigger than the last. Some that accommodated all of Deontay Wilder's demands, yet he continually turned them down. Fanon won't tell you those things.
He's a revisionist.
Here's what he'll tell you.
I'm not saying that I believe that Anthony Joshua and Eddie Hearn were actually serious about fighting him.
There it is. Little old Fanny Fanon. He doesn't think that Eddie Hearn and Anthony Joshua were serious about fighting Wilder, even though they made repeated offers, each one bigger than the last, to this man. Yet little old Fanny Fanon, he doesn't believe they were serious. Well, let's see what Shelley Finkel had to say as to whether or not they were serious.
Do you believe they were acting in good faith by making the offer that they're genuinely interested in getting Deontay to come over?
Yes, but we also feel when Deontay knocks Joshua out, we want millions and millions of people to see it. And at this point, the zone doesn't have that.
See that? After a while, even little old Shirley Winkle had to admit that effort, serious and sizable efforts, were being put forth on the part of Team Joshua to get Wilder in the ring. And his issue wasn't whether or not they were actually being serious. His issue was how many people would see the fight. Now, this doesn't necessarily align with Fanny Fanon's little narrative and the bubble that he lives in, but that's the point. That when the facts, the reality of things themselves, don't align with this kind of guy's narrative, he'll just embellish the truth, stretch it, and bend it to his liking. This isn't news, folks. It's propaganda, plain and simple.